Hey, welcome back. Today we're looking at My Last Duchess by Robert Browning, which is a poem about a crazy jealous husband. First, let's hear it, and then we'll discuss.
That's my last Duchess, hanging on the wall, looking as if she were alive. I call that piece a wonder now. Frau Pandolf's hands worked busily a day, and there she stands. Would it please you sit and look at her? I said Frau Pandolf by design, for never read strangers like you her pictured countenance, the depth and passion of that earnest glance. But to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I, and seemed as they would ask me, if they durst, how such a glance came there. So not the first of you to turn and ask thus. Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only called that spot of joy to the Duchess' cheek. Perhaps Frau Pandolf chanced to say, my lady's mantle laps over her wrist too much, or paint must never hope to reproduce the faint half-flush that dies along her throat. Such stuff was courtesy, she thought, and cause enough for calling up that spot of joy. She had a heart. How shall I say? Too soon made glad, too easily impressed. She liked whate'er she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. Sir, 'twas all one. My favor at her breast, the dropping of the daylight in the west, the bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her. All and each would call from her alike the approving speech, or blush, at least. She thanked men, good, but thanked, somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900-years-old name with anybody's gift. Who'd stoop to blame this sort of trifling? Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such a one, to say just this or that in you disgusts me. Here you miss, or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours, forsooth, and made excuse, e'en then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. Oh, sir, she smiled, no doubt, whene'er I passed her. But who passed without much the same smile? This grew. I gave commands. Then all smiles stopped together. There she stands, looking as if alive. Will it please you rise? Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity, which Klaus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me. Now let's break this poem apart and see what's inside. The poem begins with the Duke of Ferrara giving a speech to the servant of a count. And we figure out by the end of the poem that he's actually after the count's daughter, along with, presumably, a pretty healthy dowry. And as he's talking to this servant, he's talking about his past wife. The poem really takes place in front of a picture of his dead wife. As the poem unfolds, we get more and more uncomfortable with the speaker. Why is he telling all of this to the servant of a count whose daughter he's about to marry? It sounds almost like he's giving a subtle warning to his new wife's family about what he expects from her. As they sit down at first in front of the picture, which no one is allowed to ever see unless the Duke shows it to them, they observe the expression on the Duchess's face. She has such an enthusiastic and happy expression on her face. There's a depth and passion of her earnest glance, he says. And it's so striking that anyone who sees the picture asks him about it. He explains by saying, "Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only called that spot of joy into the Duchess' cheek." There's a deep sense of jealousy there, and betrayal. And pretty quickly after that, we notice that the painter might have been a little too complimentary of the Duchess there. And so at this point in the poem, we begin to wonder, oh, is she flirting with the painter? Is there something else going on between her and the painter? No wonder this guy's so angry at her. And then he goes on and says, she had a heart, how shall I say, too soon made glad, too easily impressed. She liked whate'er she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. We get a real feeling that, wow, is she just, like, flirting with everybody? Is she really promiscuous? What's going on with this girl? And then we get a list of things that actually called this expression up into her face. Sir, 'twas all one, my favor at her breast. The dropping of the daylight in the west. A bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her. The white mule she rode with round the terrace. And then we begin to realize
that this Duke is a psychopath. He's really bothered by the fact that she likes sunsets and cherries and mule rides as much as she likes his own presence. He's jealous of a sunset. And he goes on and says, she thanked men, good, but thanked somehow I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift. So the Duke thinks that by marrying her, he's given her the greatest gift of all time, his name and his family. And therefore, for the rest of her life, she should just simper at his feet and bow down and worship him and thank him for his amazing gift. The guy is a total creep. And he goes on to talk about how he can't even bring himself to correct her on this because that would be stooping, and he never stoops. He's way too proud to tell her that this bothers him. And if she's just going to keep on smiling at all kinds of things, and not only exclusively at him, he's going to do something about it. Who passed without much the same smile? This grew. I gave commands. Then all smiles stopped together. He already said he wasn't going to lower himself by correcting her. So what commands did he give that stopped all of her smiles? It sure sounds like he just killed her. Jealousy is a scary thing, and no one writes it better than Robert Browning. Robert Browning was a really very pleasant person. He had a very happy home life, a lovely marriage, and wonderful son, but he liked to write poems imagining the perspectives of crazy people. You should check out some of his other really wonderful poems, namely Porphyria's Lover. He has a fascinating way of exploring the inside of another person's mind. It's interesting how the Duke of Ferrara is okay with all but confessing murder to this servant of the Count whose daughter he's about to marry. He's laying on a lot of pressure. Hopefully he'll get the hint and marry his daughter to someone else. The poem ends with the Duke pointing out one more piece in his collection of art, Neptune taming a seahorse. Powerful god Neptune taming a small creature. Maybe like the Duke of Ferrara wants to tame the wife. One more quick fun fact. There's a word for poems that are written about art. They're called ekphrastic. Isn't that a fantastic word? Ekphrastic? So for a poem that's full of creepy, twisted, jealous love, power? This one's pretty great. Can you think of any modern examples of stories that are told around the concept of jealousy, especially intense and almost psychotic jealousy like this one? I don't know of anyone who does better justice to the topic than Robert Browning. Thanks again for watching. Click to subscribe or to watch another video, and I'll see you next time.